All right, hi there. Thanks for joining us today. Welcome to this ING Backend Guild meetup. Tonight we'll have a story about building a reactive payment system, and we'll have Igmar with us tonight. He's going to be going through his presentation, but he's going to stop twice for comments. So you can post your comments and questions as you go. With no further ado, well, this is Igmar.
Hello. Good evening. I'm Igmar. I'm with ING. I'm a chapter lead. And currently, we're working on a payment engine. As the presentation says, I'm doing this for my kids' room. So the light is not really an ideal one, but it should be good enough for everybody. This is an extended version of the presentation I did in Stockholm on JFocus. I'm going to start with a small thing I always say up front in the presentation, and that's, in my opinion, that if you want to write a scalable, reliable system design, it should be a reactive system. I'll come back on that part later. I work at ING Payments, and of course, in payments, it's all about the money. If you, as a customer, send money to an ING customer, it ends up on that ING account. And the other way around, if ING sends money to a customer somewhere else, that money is also correctly transferred within the time limits that are currently set for that. Usually, payments are processed within one day. If you do instant payments, that's done within a couple of seconds. This presentation is about the payment engine that does not do the real-time payments, but does the batching payments. So payments are processed in a number of batches throughout the day. The system is called the Clearing and Settlement Hub. If you send money to a different customer, it doesn't directly go to the other bank. There's a clearing party in between that collects all the payments that banks send to it, does the initial shuffling of money. So if you send money to ABN, ABN gets the part that ING owes it, the other way around. And at the end, there's a balance made, and the transaction then gets transferred to the other bank. That's the only thing that the clearing and settlement mechanism does. The clearing and settlement hub that we designed and implemented is ING's gateway to that system. So what it basically does is that it collects all payments from other systems, from ING's ideal system, from maybe bigger customers that have a direct interface with ING. If you go to my ING and you do a manual transfer, that also lands in the system. And we do a number of things with it. We validate it. At the end, everything is written to a file in a certain way. And after that is done, we send it out to the clearinghouses, in this case, EBA or Deacons. For booking purposes, we also do a booking if you send out a file, because that file represents an amount of money. Well, that money needs to be transferred in an accountable way. Files need to be archived, because if a customer comes back after 30 days or half year and say, hey, that transfer didn't go well, or I didn't send it, then ING is legally obligated to prove that we either received the payment or sent it out. And at the end, reconsolidation is done because ING's bookkeeping needs to be in order. So the blocks here, the PP blocks, are payment providers. That can be different parties with an ING that actually send those transactions. Advice are financial institutions that are parties that actually process payment but delegate the actual execution to ING. So payment goes into the clearing settlement hub and goes to EBA or Equens in a file, and that file content is specific for that clearing settlement hub. Content is all XML, but there is difference in files that you can send to EBA and to Equens in a way that that file is built and what data, what XML data is actually sent to that. The starting point about 2 years ago. ING does a lot of payments in a pretty high volume. You need to think hundreds or in some cases thousands a second. We have a lot of legacy system like most banks do. And that means that payments move around in a lot of different formats. Some systems have version 1 of a certain format, some do version 8. Your clearing and settlement hub mechanism needs to do version 7, and you need to take that into account. There's also no room for error. If you send out a payment twice, it will be processed twice. It is very good if you get your salary. It's very bad if that happens to be your mortgage payment. And it needs to be scalable and resilient because we cannot afford downtime of these systems. It needs to be up and running 24/7 every day of the year. Of course, we have a certain set of building blocks that are common within ING. We use Java as the main language. We started with 1.8. We currently are on 11. Payments processing happens to use Cassandra, the NoSQL store, as data storage. We use ClusterFS for shared storage. It's deployed to Realm machines, and the locking is a standard Elastic locking Kibana stack. So you ask, why are you going for a reactive system? If you design it well and stick to a number of guidelines, it means you can design it with no single point of failure. So you can lose every part or certain parts of your infrastructure without directly affecting payments. It also means that if you design it well, there will be no performance bottlenecks. A key part of this is that you have backtracing. That means that you can process no more at a time that you can really handle at the moment. So you can tell the party that is sending your data, please stop sending me data because I can't handle more. It also means that parts in the system are loosely coupled. If you do a proper reactive system, it's message driven. So communication is done by messages. It also means that certain messages come in, certain messages go out. And that is the interface that that part is actually handling at that point. So you can also test it as an individual part. It also means you get scalability for that. And what I consider important, that failure in a system is just an event. It's not a meltdown. It's not, hey, I get a persistence error, I just stop processing at that point. Of course, you need to handle it. You need to maybe park the message or you need to retry it. But it's not a catastrophic failure. I personally can also consider it that it's actually testable. And a testable is easier because it's message driven. So you can easily mock things. You know that if you send message one, you get message two in response. If that's not the case, then of course something is wrong. That's just easier to test because you don't have to test individual functions. You just test the interface, and how it's implemented, you don't really care about it. So in general, if you have a reactive system, it's responsive because you want fast feedback. It's resilient. It's elastic because it should be able to scale, and it's message driven. We have chosen Akka's implementation within wholesale banking. It's the JVM implementation. There's also an Akka.net. It's heavily based on the Actor model that was first implemented in Erlang. And it also gives you a implementation of reactive streams. And that's present in JDK 9 plus. And it's called Apaka. So that basically means you have the source, a sync, and everything that comes with it. But also it gives you this large list of just a subset of connectors that you can out of the box use. They're all non-blocking. They're all reactive. They all provide back pressure. And if you use any of them, it's just out of the box. You just configure some connection parameters or some paths, and you can just immediately start using them. It also makes it that you're able to develop a lot faster than that you need to all implement by hand. Okay, I'm going to stop the slides for now. Time for the first round of questions. Are there any?
I don't think we have questions yet, actually. I do have one, though. What's the load of the application you've built?
The load? The end load?
Yeah.
About 500 payment transactions per second.
Okay. It's quite consecutive.
Yeah.
Okay.
Payments coming back. In nighttime, the payments that were posted during the night come in. So then you see there's a huge peak. And of course, when everybody goes to bed, there are not a lot of transactions because when people are in bed, they usually don't do payments. So it's usually based on peak loads.
Okay. Oh, we do have a question.
You get a from the clearinghouse, and that file contains 400,000 transactions. So if that file comes in, you need to process them. So that's another peak. And on the other side, if you write out a file, that's another peak, because then you start sending out the transactions to that clearinghouse, and then you're going to get feedback for those 400,000 transactions, which also means that the system will be more loaded at that point. So it's not 500 transactions per second during the whole
you're
day.
You're working with peaks.
It's more on average, yes.
Okay. There's a question from the audience. How do you connect with the other systems? Do you use Kafka?
We did start with Kafka, but for some political reasons, it didn't really fit the building patterns. Most communication is done over EMS, and files get in over XFB, which is a kind of FTP on steroids. I also see a question on the move to JDK 11. In our case, it just basically built out of the box, mainly because Akka is already compliant with JDK 11 implementation, and so is our code in a lot of places. So for us, it was just basically a matter of just doing a recompile and starting with that. We are currently on Akka Classic, so not the type version. Reason for that is because when we started the project, type was not stable yet. The API was still changing a lot. So at the end, we'll still move to typed. We are already changing internals to cope with that, mainly because messages that you can send and receive are very strict. In the old version, you could just send anything and receive anything, and you need to deal with that in code. With typed, that will result in compile errors.
Okay. Let's go again.
Yeah, my
user screen.
I decided to lock my screen.
I just make a dance.
Yes, we did configure Scala. Management was against that because the amount of people that knew Scala within wholesale banking payments is virtually zero, and they consider it a too big risk. Do you spring, but only for certain parts of the API?
Wow. If we get so many questions, maybe we can answer a bit more at the end.
I'll
stop when you want, Igmar.
I'll do one more. Producer consumer patterns. We do one producer per JVM. It has to do with the fact that we use EMS and the Alpaca implementation of JMS in general has one big downside, is that you cannot share connections between parts of your code. So if you look at the Kafka producer consumer, then you when you create a connection, it expects a already built connection setting POJO, and for EMS it creates a new connection for every building block that you build. So that creates a lot of EMS JMS connections due to error handling. So we have one producer that is the central part that we put messages on the EMS bus, and we have one consumer per per JVM.
Okay. I suggest you move forward. Maybe we can pick up some new questions later.
I will go to the questions later. If needed, I'll provide answers to them after this. I'm done the talk. But for now, I also see a few questions that I will answer in the rest of my talk.
Awesome.
I noticed that I can't see this screen when my presentation is on full screen. So I don't directly see messages. Okay, second part.
Let's go. Oops. Are you sharing your screen? I don't see your screen just yet.
Apparently, my sharing was lost.
There you are.
Now okay,
go. Floor is yours.
Okay. Okay, CodeWise. Let's go very, very simple example. It makes a connection to a JMS queue called test, and it writes out things to a file and basically append messages. I've left out all the boilerplate code where you actually create the consumer settings. It's pretty standard. It's just a connection factoring where you just put in your URL, your credentials, whatever that the specific implementation needs. And this is basically the whole thing. You have a source. A source is a source with no inputs and one output. And you have a sink, that's the endpoint, that has one input and no output. And what a reactive stream implementation does is that it moves messages one by one from the source to the sink. And between that, before it goes from source to sink, there can be a number of steps. It can be a message transform. It could be that you direct it to a different stream. It could be that you drop it. It could be that you do something else with it. You can put it on Elastic, you can put it on an Amazon pub sub mechanism. All the implementations have in common, it's one source, it's one thing. And if you and do proper code in between, you can actually reuse large part of the code, because the messages are usually either bytes or byte strings or strings, and you can easily transform them. Do all kind of operations, put them in a shared library and share them with implementations. If you then need to go from EMS to Kafka, you only need to change small parts of your application instead of doing a lot of refactoring. I think this is the most basic example that you can get. It actually does something useful. This is actually a bit more complicated example. It takes a message from Kafka, puts it on Elastic, and commits it. You already see that it's a bit more complicated. I again left out most of the connection details. I left out the POJOs. But you can see already a big implementation or big difference here. Is that we have a message, a record that we get off Kafka, that's just the record that the Kafka client provides you. It's called consumer record in this case. And we map that message to a POJO called moving. After that is done, it goes to the next state, the via. Via is basically say, well, if you have a message, then go to this flow. Because a map is, you have input and output, and a flow, and a via is that you have a new flow that you encounter. And the flow can do a lot of things. So in this case, it goes to Elasticsearch. You have a default factory that you can say, give me a flow with some parameters. You have a client, you have a JSON mapper, you create and give it a couple of things that can work with, and then you get an immutable object back. And that immutable object is then passed to via. And the result of that is the result that the Elasticsearch client gives you. And that's a right result, and that's either good or bad. It's pretty binary. What this thing also gives you is that this whole part is a blueprint. If you run, leave out the last two lines, it will still compile, but if you didn't run it, it doesn't do anything. It is because all Alpaca or reactive teams are defined as flows, and a flow by itself is just a blueprint. If you need to do anything with it, you need to materialize it. It basically means you actually make it do something. It also means that the object or the end result that you get can be shared. You can even store it in a database, restore it later, and then just reuse it. It also means that after you have created that blueprint, you cannot change it anymore. All objects in Akka are generally immutable. So once you have created it, you cannot change it anymore, except by creating a new object. There's some comments on that. Well, one is Kafka consumer with object creation. You map it to a JSON object. An Elastic flow with content. It's a bit more complicated because at the end, Kafka requires you that after you have consumed the message, you commit the offset. The emails you can do auto-commit. For Kafka, you can also probably use auto-commit, but I mean, don't use it because it then does one commit per message. It's really bad for performance. But at the end, it doesn't map with your value, and then at the end, it does a bulk commit. Or what we call drain the output, because the output needs to go somewhere at the end. This is in general how reactive things look like. If you have a very simple example, in the next slide, I have a bit more complex example. It actually is an extract from the payment engine itself. And here you have it. This is a bit more complex example where you can basically say, do a read message, you create a flow that basically tells you that it's okay, you create a POJO, create more logic. These are all basically small kind of chunks that take one piece of data, do something with it, and output it again. And that do something with it can also mean that you log it to a file or log it to your log file or to whatever that you want. That's also an operation. In this case, we do a number of checks with it, and at the end, it will either be okay or not, and depending on the status of your previous action, you can do something with it. You can put it on a topic, or you can put it on a different topic, depending on what the result of that flow is. And this is generally how all the reactive streams descriptions look like. If you look at the payment engines we built, we have a lot of topics that we consume from. We have a lot of different message types that we consume. And all of them are built like this. So one description per consumer, as we call it. And at the end, it will be fed to the batching system, and that will determine where to send it and will actually make sure it lands up in a file. For us, this reuse of logic means we need to write less code at the end. And it's maintainable, I think, at the end. You need to write less code, and you can already use a library that does all the hard work for you and has a lot of integrations out of the box. It just saves you a lot of time. You don't have to deal with threats. You don't have to deal with complex ways of doing all kind of internal management. You just create it, you materialize it, and it just works or not. So that is about the choices we made with Akka and with the reactive system. This is a very global overview of how it looks like. You input data from JMS, from a file, and from Kafka. Kafka comes from a topic, JMS comes from a queue. And a file is just, at the end, we get a trigger message, say, hey, you have a file here, stop doing your magic with it. We have Alexa that basically chops up the incoming message in tokens. Then we have a parser that basically validates if it's really valid XML. So if you have a star tag, you at a certain point want to see an end tag for that same star tag. And at the end, there's validation. We use XSD heavily within banks in general. And you can do a lot of checking in there, but not everything. Some things cannot be expressed in an XSD. And then at that point, we do manual validation, which in our case is for manual code. The validation for everything that's in an XSD is generated in our case. After that message is validated, it goes to a message router, and the message router has one job: figure out where to send it and send it. Because if you get a payment, you need to determine which clearinghouse you need to send it to. They have a big table of bank codes, and for those bank codes, we determine to which clearinghouse we send it. Sometimes we can send it to both of them, and then we have a preference based on business logic. So after the message is routed, it goes to a transaction handler. Well, the transaction handler is nothing but a huge array where all data is stored in memory. We also persist to Cassandra, but we only write to Cassandra. Because keeping data in memory is cheap. If you need to recover 400,000 or more transactions from Cassandra, that is usually a costly operation. If we can keep things in memory, we keep them in memory. We only let go of the objects in memory when we have to, either because some timers have expired or that we actually get feedback for the file, and then we process the file and then we just remove it from memory because we don't need it anymore. Files are split up in blocks. Blocks contain transactions of one certain type, and you cannot mix them. You cannot do a payment transaction with a payment return and send them in the same block. It doesn't work that way. So every block does one transaction type. A payment is called a Pax 8 in our case. If you do a return payment because the account doesn't exist, then you get your money back. We call that a Pax 4. they're all in their own box and batch them in a certain order and put them in a file. Once that file is full because it has limits, both in the amount of money that you can put in and as well as the amount of transactions, it gets handed over to a coordinator whose only job is what if that file gets sent out and what if you get the feedback for that file. Because feedback normally arrives within 15 minutes if you send it out. If it takes longer, then we need to alert operations for that. Because it's an exceptional situation, and usually that means something is wrong, and somebody needs to check it. So at the end, the coordinator just makes sure we have a file, it's created properly, we send it out, we get feedback. After we get feedback, we process it. And after that is processed, the job in general of the most of the components are done. And internally already a new batch has been created. It's also, this picture is per JVM. So if we have four JVMs and one of them has actually died for some reason because the host goes down or whatever reason, you want to know that. And well, Akka itself gives you cluster events that you can say, well, the node is down. Don't know at that point what was actually on that node, because there's no central registry of actors in Akka. They're just single entities, and you need to keep your own state of them, because a distributed registry of all registered actors is just too expensive and doesn't scale. So you can do a watching actor in Akka, where you can basically say, hey, I have this actor, and if something happens with it, I want to know that. If you do it cross JVM, this JVM stops working, then most likely this actor will know that. This one stops, then this one will know that. This one stops, this actor will know that. And at the end, you can take action on it. If you expect it to terminate, then you don't take action. If you don't expect it, you need to recreate the information that you actually lost in the actor. Basically, means you need to get transactions from Cassandra, load them in memory again, and see what you need to do with processing. This is actually a very powerful model that actually can help you to reach your scalability goals. Because what you see in a lot of other systems is that it uses a database. It basically is one big shared state element, and then it hammers the database constantly to keep the state synced. Which usually means that your database is your performance bottleneck. Cassandra by itself is very scalable, but also that has limits. And the less that you interact with it, the less performance problems, of course, you will get. And keeping things in memory at the moment is cheap and it's fast. Second round of questions.
Popping in the screen again.
Yes.
All right. And we're moving your screen. Don't stop sharing. It's going to come back later. We have one question from Alexandru.
Yes. Your consistency requirements. The consistency requirements that we have is don't lose payments, basically. So that what we do internally is that we consume a payment, but we don't acknowledge the message on JMS until the transaction is confirmed in the database. And confirmed as in we want quorum writes confirmed. That means that we can lose any node at a point, because if the transaction has not been confirmed in Cassandra yet, we don't acknowledge it. So the next node will then get the same message and we just process it. Of course, there is a small race window between that, because at the point that you committed to Cassandra and then you die, then of course you still have that message written, but nobody knows about it. That means that a new node will process the same message, It will do a duplicate check in that case. And then in that case, we'll just override it in Cassandra. Modelize is we consider all nodes equal. There's no leader node, there's no master node. All nodes do exactly the same things. So if we lose a node, you just lose certain part of data and that will be recovered on a different node. And that's all driven by either ActiveWatch or by the Akka cluster events. On the question for in-memory data, no, it's just an in-memory array. Because it's internal state data in an actor. So we don't need to use fancy things because actors are encapsulated by default. That is the whole point of using actors. So only the actor controls the data. And actors have a very small chunk of the whole file in memory. So in our case, it's 100 transactions because it happened to be a good fit memory-wise, network-wise, and we just use that one. On the network partitions, we use Akka Split Brain Resolver, but in general, on network partitions is that we don't care much. The current setup downs half of the cluster. If a node in DC1 and DC2 don't see each other anymore, there's a certain part of the DC that we then down. But in general, we don't really care about it. If the node is downed, we also get terminated events for the actors, and we just respawn them on a different node. Once we lose track of an actor, we never write to it again. So as soon as that actor is recovered, we immediately seal it off. We consider it immutable. So even if it does exist on multiple places, it doesn't affect processing itself because the state itself is consistent. From Rob Hatting. Is it eventually consistent? Cassandra is indeed. But what we currently do if we went Cassandra, that if we do quorum wipes. So that if you do quorum wipes and you get acknowledgement, you know that the majority of nodes acknowledge your write. Also note that we never read back from Cassandra. So even if it takes, for example, 2 seconds, we don't read back. So we don't really care that. Of course, it's an issue if you write it and then immediately or the JVM or where that did the write actually stops working. Then in theory, if that consistently takes a long while, it could be that that node reads data back and doesn't exist. In that case, then ops has to manually intervene with that. The whole CI/CD pipeline, it's the ING way, it's Jenkins at the moment. We will move to a Kubernetes-like setup in the future. Indeed.
Are those containers already? Or
Not yet. No. We just onboarded the container platform. So I have an account, I can log in and I can do things, but we don't use it at the moment.
Okay. All right. You do have one more part, right?
Yes.
Yes. Let's go.
Can you still see it?
Yes, we can.
So, at the end. What happened? Well, it's in production. And you think, well, that's not a big deal. Well, if you're in a bank, that's actually a very big milestone if your application actually becomes production ready. We have a lot of rules that we need to comply to, especially if you do payments processing. We need to have functional tests in place that actually prove that it does what it's designed to do and that it does what ING expects it to do. Performance is pretty okay. We never really tuned it, especially not the internals, because we were still ramping up the volumes. So we still have some places that are not very effective in the way they actually do things. And it actually is a pretty decent set of maintainable code. We actually took a lot of care that we actually write code that can be reused later by other teams. So the whole XML parsing, picking XML, making it into the right POJOs, it's all protobuf internally, it's all generated code. The validation is also fully generated, so we never have to maintain it. We actually took care that we actually write code that other teams can also use. Okay. Of course, we also, in some occasions, made a bit of a mess out of it. If you work in any distributed systems, you're going to have a unique set of issues at your hand. That's just the way it works. In general, networks behave bad. They have packet loss, they have latency. You have switches that drop out, you have loose data center connectivity. Distributed systems are eventually consistent. If a node in one data center does something, it takes time before it propagates to the other nodes. So you need to design for that, but it's not an issue. If you do an action and you need to wait until all other nodes have picked up that action, it will become a bottleneck really fast. Blocking operations in a message-driven system are basically a no-go, but they're everywhere. If you use a connection to Oracle, it's blocking. If you use file system operations, by default, it's blocking. If you don't want to use that, then you need to take message. For example, in case of using the Oracle driver, then you need to have create a different thread pool where the executions to Oracle actually execute. If you use file systems, then Alpaca has an interface. You can actually write files without blocking. But that's not that easy. It has a very awkward interface that you need to get used to. You need to deal with these kind of issues. But also why you need to start testing multiple nodes as soon as possible. Even if it behaves really bad, you will learn from that. Because if you are on a distributed system, things will simply work differently as expected. The ordering of messages, for example, is not guaranteed. You send out A, B, C, and you expect a response. The response can be a B, C, A. But your system should be able to handle that. If you expect order in a distributed system, you will be usually disappointed. Also, adapt your test to that. Things might go out of order, and it doesn't mean it's a bad thing, depending on what your requirements are, but your test needs to be able to deal with it, especially your functional test. If you use features, use things that are out of the box and don't go invent your own things. Akka's feature set is already very rich, use that. The decent components, the battle tested also by very big companies, PayPal, Alibaba, Apple, use it. Use those components. Don't go reinvent the wheel because you like doing it. Do resilience testing. Run it in cluster mode, kill off a random JVM and see what happens. Usually, if you think you covered all the scenarios, you probably missed a few. And if it happens in production, you will have huge issues recovering from that, and it will take a lot of time. And if you're with a bank, that's not really appreciated. If you use actors, be careful using patterns of ask and retry. Ask is that you basically say, hey, I have a message and I expect a return in that. Usable in some cases, it's also very dangerous to use in some cases. I have some slides on that later. Do proper time management. Things will fail, you need to make sure that operations take an X amount of time. Use baby steps. Don't do big bang things. If you need to do 200 actions, make sure you do 200 individual actions and not try to wrap them into one big one. And make every step idempotent. Sometimes it's a bit of extra work, but it makes your error recovery and retry logic a lot easier. If you can just do the same action 4 times without side effects, it's just easier to deal with that you need to do an action, check state, recalculate state, and do the same action again. Well, something on custom features, routers where you can send a message and it gets processed by an actor. You have cluster singletons, one actor in the whole cluster. PubSub, just like publish subscribe thing. You have sharding where you route it based on a key, and you have distributed data. It's all in a distributed system, so they all have eventual consistency issues, and things fail, and they do. Timeout management, prevent deeply nested timeouts. We did it. It went really bad. At the end, nobody exactly knew what the exact timeout for an operation was. Where you have operation A that called B, called C, called D, all at their own timeouts. What at the end, especially if you do retries in between them, what is the overall timeout of A? You need to somehow determine that and calculate that, because if you do hard-coded values, the action to C will most likely already expire before the action to B is done if you use the wrong timeout values. Take proper care of that and prevent that you make a bit of a mess out of that. So, baby steps. Don't try to do much work in a single operation. In this case, an example, you have 4,000 actors. You need to ask them a question, and you need to aggregate all the data for all the actors. Well, you can do it like this. It looks very nice, very clean code. But there's one big downside of this. This is a big bang operation. Because you wait on the completion of all the futures, it's either a yes or no. Either you get into the then accept loop, or it will fail as a whole. So if you do a lot of work in your downtown to actor 3999, and the last one fails because it doesn't respond within time, the whole operation fails, and you lose the answer that you actually got from those 3,999 other actors. So, well, this is very nice, clean code, and it works. Don't use it. Use it like this. Especially if you do need to do a lot of operations. Create a list of actors that you send data to, accumulate a list of responses, and do work with timers and ticks. And tick is just basically, it keeps the whole operation going. Just check if you already got a response. If not, then you just send out a request. You don't care if you get a response. If you don't get a response, it's fine. At the end, you just put the response directly into the result map. Because you have a correlation ID, you can just do that by ID. And you don't care if you already got it. Because if you have idempotent operations with immutable objects, you don't care because the response will always be the same. There's no need to check if it's the same response. You just add it. At the end, you need to check, of course, if you get all the responses. If yes, then you respond. It's more code. It's more work, and you need to use timers. But at the end, this is a pretty battle-proof setup where you can guarantee to do a certain set of operations. It's probably a more elegant way to do that. But this is just stupid and simple code, as I always call it. As I said, make all your operations idempotent. We didn't do that in the beginning, and then we had to do a lot of checking. At the end, we did make them idempotent, and just got rid of a lot of complex code. If it fails, then you just retry it because you can. Some systems within banks are not idempotent, and then you can't always call the system again because it sometimes does things twice. Instead of one payment, it processes two payments or two reservations. So if a call to that system fails, you need to manually check the result of that operation, which is usually manual labor, and you want to prevent it. If you make it idempotent in your own application, you can just have people do it twice, and the end result will always be the same. If you do testings, do more testing. There are a lot of issues that actually pop up in testing. Unit testing, regression testing, functional testing, the bank is pretty much required. But do not cut down on testing, no matter how hard management or the PO starts complaining about it, that you spend too much time on it. Especially for big changes, you need to have testing in place to make sure things don't break. Okay. Final round of questions.
Final round, you have questions, this is your chance. We do have a few already. The first one from Carlos about bottlenecks. How do you monitor to detect bottlenecks?
We have metrics in place. We use Kanban internally to do metrics. We do certain operations when they start and when they finish. It's a very simple time scale. So we monitor how long do certain operations take. And then you need to manually assess that. Is that okay, yes or no? If your Kafka offset commit takes 1 second, then you have a bottleneck. How fast do you expect your Cassandra writes to be? Is it 5 milliseconds? Well, then it's fine. Does it occasionally, in a lot of cases, take 20? Then it's just too long.
Okay.
It's a lot of manual work and thinking things over. And we do a lot of based on logging. If you have a distributed system with 4 nodes, you cannot stick a live debugger on that. That simply doesn't work. So you need to be able to derive every problem from your debug logging, basically. And if you can't, then you have no idea what's happening inside.
Additional question from me. Do you have like alerting already based on those metrics?
Yes, we use Prometheus for that. We just scrape it every, minute or so. And if certain values are out of bound, then we start alerting on that.
Okay.
For example, if we know that the number of batches in memory keeps rising and they never get removed, then we know that we don't get feedback. And then we need to check why we don't get feedback. Because normally it starts alerting after half an hour. But if you have a very busy morning, that can be a bit too late.
Okay. The other question from Alexandru, Alexandru is asking if the system can run on distributed across data centers.
Yes. Of course, there are a couple of conditions for that. If you use a underlying data store, it needs to be scalable and cross DC as well. Because if you have your data store in one data center only and you lose connectivity to the data center, you're dead in the water, basically. And the split brain scenarios is that we don't really care. The alerting that we do, because the application also does alerting by itself. For example, if we don't get feedback in 30 minutes, then we start calling ops out of bed. If we have a lot of persistence errors, then we also start calling ops out of bed. So we do our own alerting, and that's done by a cluster singleton because we rate limit the amount of alerts that we send out. Because if you have 500 Cassandra errors and ops get 500 text messages, they're not very happy, we noticed. But that's the only thing that we do, and for the rest we don't keep state internally. The only state is in the destination manager. That's a distributed map, and we don't care if that's consistent. if it's not consistent, the worst thing in our case that will happen is that we write out more files than we should. So if you have X transactions and that fits in two files, technically, we might write out three files or four files. But from a functional perspective, we don't care about that because it's still payments and we still send it out. Of course, you need to pay extra because you process more files. But from a technical side, we don't really care.
Okay.
So we do keep state, but very limited. We only keep state of if you have one node that has sent out a file and another node gets the feedback, you need to get a reference to the actor that actually keeps track of that whole batch. And that's what's in the distributed map. So that's the only state that we keep at the moment.
I mean, the less state, the better news, right?
Yeah, we only keep state in one place. And even if that state is not consistent, we don't care. Worst thing is that we do extra work that's not necessary, or we write out too much files, which is not necessary. And both of them are actually pretty okay. We don't do the wrong things. That's the most important thing.
Yeah. I do have two more questions that are higher up that you didn't pick earlier. One of them I'm not sure about. Maybe you can understand it better than I do. Someone is asking, why did you choose for Akka instead of Spring? I'm guessing that Spring has some kind of actor-based model.
Yeah, you can use Reactive Spring. By the time that we started, it wasn't really that mature yet. We did have a swing with it. It also was a preference of the team, so there was not really a technical reason to do so. But from a commercial and business perspective, ING already is a Liveband customer, so we already have a lot of teams in ING that actually use Akka, so it just makes it easier to just use it. Is there a technical reason to do so? No, not really. No. It's just more that the team already liked it and there's a lot of experience in the team.
Yeah, if there is expertise in the house, makes sense as well, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
There's also reason, just a business reason.
I have a last question, which we probably can use as a conclusion. Someone is asking, but you also already touched it a little bit in your lessons learned. Maybe you can come back to that. Someone's asking we mentioned the advantages of moving to reactive. What are the bottlenecks? What are the challenges? Maybe you can use that as a conclusion for someone that has to decide tomorrow.
I think mostly the fact that it's eventually consistent, which is sometimes a real pain, and the fact that things do not happen in a certain order. And that can be very problematic, that if you expect A, B, and C to happening in sequence and it doesn't, they need to explicitly deal with it. But that's just the way that an eventually consistent system works. And Akka does not offer guarantees when it comes to message order.
Yeah.
So you need to actually deal with it. And you need to test for that. That's also the reason why you need to run it in cluster mode as soon as possible, because then you'll have these issues popping up. If you run it on single nodes, then everything is exactly as you would expect. Yeah. Everything happens in order. Everything happens in a guaranteed order. And that all goes down the drain as soon as you start running it in cluster mode.
Okay. And this additional question from me, I don't have experience with it. Can you run in cluster mode on your local machine?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
Yes, actually do that for testing. We have running locally Cassandra, running locally EMS, and we run a 3-node Cassandra cluster locally on a laptop.
Okay.
And it just works. Of course, you have great latency and everything works very fast. And you don't have network issues. But you can use it for testing. You can also use it for resilience testing if you just fire out certain ports at a certain point, then you can just see what happens on your local machine. It sometimes make testing a bit easier.
Okay.
Because you have all the logging available in one central place and you can actually debug it then if you want.
All right. We're reaching the end. Thanks a lot, Igmar.
Yes, you're welcome.
Thank you for joining. And see you for another stream from the G meetups. And I will go end the broadcast now. Have a nice evening, everybody. Cheers.